Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for this very generous introduction. Something that was not mentioned was the important fact that I used to be a professor in the United States during the hippie years. And I taught a classroom of 500 pre-medical students in all stages of dress and undress. There were young women sitting in the front row breastfeeding their babies, and the students brought their dogs along, which was allowed at Cornell. And when the students liked what I said, they whistled or screamed and the dogs barked. And when the students didn't like what I said, the same thing happened. So why do I tell you this? If you feel that I have not been clear enough or you want to contradict me, stop me by any means you deem necessary, because nothing passes me anymore, okay? I've come to you today to talk about science. Why? I've been a professor all my professional life, and in retrospect, it became clear to me that we professors talk to you students a lot about how to do science, but we rarely talk to you about what science really is, how it shapes you, what it demands from you, and what it takes to be successful in it. And that's what I will try to do today. The best way to illustrate the essence of science is to quote from a speech one of my American colleagues gave many years ago to the incoming class at Harvard Medical School. I forgot his exact words, of course, but he said something like this: about half of what we are going to teach you is going to be wrong. Unfortunately, I cannot tell you today which half. The professors in the audience nodded in quiet agreement, but the parents, who were about to pay through their nose to have their kids educated at Harvard, were not amused. Like most of society, they expected science to produce safe, permanent knowledge, to safeguard it, and to teach it to young people. Like politicians, they consider science and knowledge virtually as synonyms, as inseparable parts of the same whole with the same mission. And since fulfilling that mission is very expensive, politics and society wants to control science as closely as it can. This view of science and knowledge, however, distorts reality and causes many of the problems we scientists are facing today. After all, the main business of science is not knowledge. The main business of science is ignorance. We scientists try to convert ignorance into knowledge. And the act of conversion is much more important to us than the product. Most full-blooded researchers consider the knowledge they have helped create almost as a kind of byproduct. They gladly leave up to others to teach and to put into textbooks and to write reviews on. The true home of a researcher is not the safe haven of proven knowledge, but its outermost fringe, where knowledge stares into the face of ignorance. To a true researcher, a textbook of bioengineering is not bioengineering. It's the history of bioengineering, something he or she already knows or should know. True bioengineering would be an exciting discussion in the laboratory, a useful hint by a colleague, or an exciting seminar on a new breakthrough in bioengineering. Science does not make our life easier or quieter or safer. It makes our life freer and more exciting. Science is the permanent revolutionary. Science hates dogmas and preconceived notions and never stops trying to show them wrong. Science, like innovative art, tends to unsettle us. And that's why totalitarian regimes have always suppressed both. Osip Mandelstam, the Soviet poet, had this to say on Stalin's cultural terror. In Russia, so said Mandelstam, in Russia, poetry is more respected than anywhere else because it gets people killed. Is there any other place on earth where poetry is such a common motive for murder? In fact, he was murdered by Stalin soon afterwards. On the other side of the fence, the then Soviet ambassador to Great Britain, Ivan Maisky, had this to say without any bitterness or cynicism in 1941. He said, in the Soviet Union, there is no place for pure science. Control everywhere. Our knowledge is not something we can neatly wrap up, label, and leave in numbered bins forever. It's more like a zoo of wild animals that run up against the their cages, break through their cages, and interbreed to form unexpected new progeny. Jean-Paul Sartre has once said, "It is not we who make war. War makes us." And the same thing could be said about scientific knowledge. Through the onslaught of scientific inquisitiveness, it changes all the time and changes us in the process. Now, we may be able to control it in the short term. We may even be able to falsify it in the short term. But in the long run, knowledge is always stronger than us. It follows its own rules and laws which we don't know too well and which we certainly cannot change or control. Now, you may have heard the famous saying which is attributed to Victor Hugo, "Nothing is as irresistible as an idea whose time has come." Now, this quote is not authentic, probably, but it is still very much true. Now, for us scientists, it is not so bothersome that knowledge is never permanent, that it changes all the time. Because we have an ambivalent relationship to knowledge. We do everything we can to create it from ignorance. But once we have created it, we distrust it immediately and try to prove it wrong. We are the permanent skeptics. In fact, our ultimate goal is not to produce knowledge. The highest goal of a researcher is to produce new ignorance, to discover something of which we didn't even know that we didn't know it. When Max Planck discovered the energy quantum, or Sigmund Freud the subconscious, or Gregor Mendel the genes, they discovered immense new continents of ignorance, which we then could explore and, with the knowledge gained, change our view of the world. Very few scientists are privileged to attain these highest goals, and they change the course of science forever. Now, knowledge and science are very uneasy bedfellows. Knowledge reflects the past. It's a child of the past. And in a constantly changing world, we'll never be able to control the future. This can only be done through the eternally youthful power of scientific research. For this, it takes people who see what everybody sees, but then think what nobody has thought before. It takes people with this childlike, intuitive playfulness who just guess that the path from A to C does not lead via B, as everybody suspects, but maybe via X or Z. How do you get this? How can you attain these qualities of a scientist? I will now come, after this brief discussion about what science is and what it gives you, some ideas on what it takes to do such things. The main thing a researcher needs is not so much intelligence. There are many other things that are needed. You need a good health. You need the right partner. And you need luck. But more than anything you need is courage. It takes great courage to question accepted dogmas, to think against the stream. And only those who can swim against the current have a chance to discover new wellsprings of knowledge. It takes people who think alone, who are not very pleasant in an organized group. They're often the troublemakers, but they change the way we think and see. Now, there's a Nobel laureate who lived in Chicago half a century ago, Harold Urey, and he made a famous statement. He said, since courage is the main attribute of a creative scientist, scientific talent, in the end, is a question of character. And there was an American writer who wrote a very beautiful phrase to those researchers who are not afraid to steer their ship into dangerous waters if these waters promise the excitement of new discovery. His name was John A. Shedd, and he wrote the following: a ship in harbor is safe. But that's not what ships are made for. Remember that. How do you get courage? You don't get it in a lecture or buying a book, courage. You get it through osmosis, by being around courageous people, through role models. You watch them and you imitate them. That's how we humans are built. We watch each other and try to imitate each other. That's why humanity has progressed. And that's why role models are so important in your education. Most of the young people in this room, which is everybody, of course, don't realize how important role models are for your character development. People whom you watch, whom you admire, or at least respect, and then try to emulate for the rest of your life. I've been extremely lucky in not only having had wonderful parents, but also in having had a few outstanding teachers who still influence my thoughts and my action. There are two other attributes which you need to make courage effective. You need passion and you need patience. You need these two to allow courage to exert its force over the long run, to go through dry spells when nothing happens over months, or maybe a year's work goes down the drain because of an unexpected mistake or a new discovery. Courage alone won't help you. How do you get passion? I believe there's only one way you can choose to be passionate. You must choose the right parents. It has to be in your genes or your epigenes. You can't learn that. But you can learn patience the same way you can learn, to some extent, courage, by being around patient people, to watch them when they repeat an experiment over and over again. They don't complain, they keep going. And this triad of courage, passion, and patience is something you should question yourself about. Certainly, if I look back on my own career, most of my failings, of which there are many, and I won't tell you about those, were caused by the fact that I hadn't been courageous enough. It's the courage to go for the long haul instead of the quickie paper, to pick a real tough project, which may mean failure. But if you don't gamble high, you can't win high. And it's your choice what you want to do. Now, you may ask, what should one avoid in science. Students often ask me, Professor Schatz, what would you do differently if you were to start all over again? And then I think for a while, and there are many things that come to my mind. I'll just tell you about two, which I consider particularly important and a dangerous impediment to creative research. One, I would devote much more of my time to teaching. By teaching, I don't mean the recitation of facts by drawing physical formulas on the blackboard or teaching the Krebs cycle in biology. I mean true teaching, because these facts can be now transmitted much more efficiently by modern electronic means or by small groups. But I mean the teaching in which I stand in front of a class like I'm doing now and share with my students my views on science, on the importance of certain developments, about the dark sides of science, and what a scientific view of the world means for the view of us and the people around us. If I think back to my classroom teaching, where I taught a class of, this was in Basel, of only 200 students, now well-behaved and well-dressed, of course. We're talking Basel, after all. Then I'm ashamed that I didn't put more of my heart into it. I hope I taught reasonably well, but I wanted to get back to the lab. But here I had 200 intelligent young people sitting still and listening to me for 90 minutes, whatever I said. My own children would have never done that. What a unique chance to shape a whole generation of important people. Now, I thought research was so much more important. But both are important, because teaching gives you yourself get a new view on science and a new perspective of what it means, what you're doing. And now I meet all the time young people who come up to me and tell me, I was your student, and often I don't recognize them, of course, but then they tell me, they usually remember the jokes, but I hope that they also remember some of the other things, and it's very heartwarming to see that you have had an effect. If your own career should get you into academic teaching, give it the attention it deserves. Don't blow it. We need people who stand in front of young people and do a good job in true teaching so that they can become role models. Now, if we don't provide role models to our students, and when we select professors, we only look for number of papers and citation indices, not for personality, which is terrible. If we don't do a better job in giving our students good role models, the young people will look for role models somewhere else. And I bet you most of these places won't be very good ones. Some of you who are older may remember this Bhagwan guru who lived in Oregon in 1980 in the United States, who had come to the States from Pune. And he had a big colony of followers, of groupies, who gave him Rolls Royces and golden Rolex watches and all kinds of things. And many of these thoughtless, fanatical groupies had studied at the best universities in the United States. What happened? These universities had been so eager to teach them to do science that they'd forgotten to educate them, to tell them what science means, what a critical mind means, what it means to trust your own mind. What are the two most important gifts a university can give to students? In terms of people, role models. In terms of thinking, the courage to believe in your own brain, to think independently, to become an autonomous human being. Now, how can you train autonomous thinking? If you want to teach people how to solve new problems, complex problems, with original, innovative thought, there's only way to do this. That's research. That's why university education must never do without research. Politicians always demand this. They say, you are paid to teach, your research is your private hobby. No, you cannot teach at the university properly if you don't do research with the students. And this is a fight which is never over. It goes on in Parliament, here in Bern, even today. Now there's another thing which I would do differently. I would spend much less time on professional travel. I grew up in post-war Austria when traveling to faraway countries was a dream luxury. And I'll never forget my first letter of invitation to an international meeting, which at the end had this magic sentence, all your expenses, including airfare, economy class, will be paid for by the organizers. That was a great feeling. And I went on to see most places in the world which had universities, and it was exciting. But I realize only now the price I had to pay for that. It's not so much the constant fatigue and the jet lag. You cannot fake it, but you can control it through willpower. But it's the fact that you have to be very organized all the time. And organization is a dangerous thing. I'll come back to that later, because it prevents you from creative thinking. Everything is planned. Every hour is planned. You're here, you're there, tomorrow you're there. Never do you have the time to sit back and let your mind wander and allow it to get some unusual connections, to get new ideas. And the other thing is what it will do to your family life and to your research group. Because when you are back, there's a huge pile of mail, you are jet-lagged, there are problems in the lab, everything happens at once, and you're not up to solving it most of the time. So all these ideas that professors run two laboratories in different places at the same time, it happens to most Nobel laureates that think they can do it. They can't. I have not met a single one who can do it. So the ideal way to run your lab is to be there and to do the random walk. Just go to the lab as you see fit and talk to people. What are you doing? What's the problem? How are you doing today? Not have office hours or fly in once a week from far away. It just won't work. That's not how science is, not how science works. So when your own profession will get you to a stage where you have to do traveling, and you will have to do traveling, to get your work known, to help your colleagues and people in the group to get a job, but keep it to an absolute minimum. I knew another role model of mine, a quaint Scotsman at Cornell University, who was as strange to the United States as I was, because his English was almost as different from American as my German. And he didn't travel much. He was a very famous scientist, and he said, I can't imitate his Scottish accent. He said, Jeff, if you stand at the airport at 6 in the morning and have to fly far away, I always ask myself, was this trip really necessary? And believe it or not, the answer is always no. So be careful about that. It's very seductive. You think you're accomplishing much. It's good for your ego, but it's bad for many other things. Now, about universities, because many of you are students. Now, universities, what is the major role of universities? They have become trade schools today, professional schools. The word university is a misnomer today. There's hardly any interaction between different disciplines. I would like to say that universities today are not very exciting places anymore. But they have a major mission, which many of them still fulfill. That is to think long-term. Universities are probably the only place on this planet where people still think what may happen in 100 years. Where else do people think such thoughts? In politics, 4 to 6 years. In business, at most 4 years. And if universities try to do short-term research, because business wants them to do that, because they get money for doing it, because politics tells them to solve deforestation, gender studies, and climate change, and whatever in the short term, they are selling out, and they lose the reason to exist. But our universities are not only threatened, by the current idea of thinking short term. They are threatened by an antiquated hierarchy. When I ran the Swiss Science and Technology Council in 2000, one of my main two goals was to make universities a less hierarchical place, so that they would have flatter hierarchies. Because hierarchy is the arch enemy of innovation. Why? Because hierarchy inhibits the free competition of ideas. It inhibits the revolutionary science. The ideal environment for innovation is what I would call a controlled chaos, which very few able research leaders can set up and maintain over the long run. There will always be hierarchy in science, but it should be a hierarchy of the mind and not of age or position. And any place where this is not fulfilled will never be a great science place today. And that's why I personally believe, and I may be wrong, but I firmly believe that places today, like the People's Republic of China, will not become a great basic research nation unless the politics change. And even Singapore, which is a far cry from the People's Republic of China today, even in Singapore, the hierarchies are too great and too rigid to allow it to become a really first-rate science place. That's what we must fight for. You see, why is organization and hierarchy so dangerous? The main purpose of an organization is to prevent unexpected events, mistakes, and violation of rules. But unexpected events, surprises, and violation of rules are at the very heart of innovative research. There is no innovative research without these things. And that's why organization and innovation are inherent enemies. Now, of course, organization is important, but the more short-term research is. When you already have the required basic knowledge and you want to apply it to a fairly well-defined specific goal, like improving the fuel efficiency of an engine or testing the efficacy of a drug in a clinical trial, a good, efficient organization can be very important. But in long-term basic research, where the goal is not clear, where you have no idea often where you're going, organization can be deadly. So remember, organization is the enemy of innovation. And coordination, another craze today, everything has to be coordinated. Coordination is the enemy of motivation. We should write this down in the textbook and send it to our politicians who run science in Switzerland. Now, that's the place to mention the current craze to direct research. There's the idea, the mistaken belief, particularly strong in Europe, but by no means absent in the United States, and very strong in China today, that research will become more efficient, whatever that means, if it is given a specific goal, and if the people are told how to do the research. Sad consequences of this craze are these research programs, which also are prominent in Switzerland, on these popular, relevant topics: cancer, AIDS, deforestation, gender studies, you name it. Often, the researchers are then told that they have to work as networks, which of course then have to be balanced geographically by language and by gender and so on. But it is absolutely insane to think that research can only be innovative if it is relevant or focused or interdisciplinary. And the question is, if a good basic research creates its own goals and methods as it goes along, and if you specify these methods top down from the beginning, the research cannot be innovative. You force it down a predetermined tube. We have to fight against this idea, and it is very hard to convince the public that research needs the freedom to find unexpected things, to create new ignorance. You cannot plan this. The best example, which I always mention to politicians, since I come from the biomedical field, is cancer research. In 1986, the Israeli government wanted to give money for cancer research. And one research lab proposed to improve magnets. People thought it was crazy, and of course he didn't get the money. But today we know the efficient magnets were the key to MRI, to magnetic resonance imaging, which is now today one of the most powerful methods to see in very early stages cancerous growth in the human body. Fantastic means. Nobody could have predicted this. And almost everybody today, sooner or later, will lie in one of these tubes and then think about this problem. Now, you see, politicians and the general public think that research, particularly basic research, long-term research, is a highly structured, planned, organized process in which researchers patiently put one stone on top of the other until the pre-planned building is completed. But innovative research is almost the exact opposite. It's highly intuitive. It's full of surprises. It's sometimes even chaotic. Innovative research is not a stroll down a carefully tended garden path. It's an expedition into the unknown wilderness where researchers often get lost. Where there's order and everything is clear, the maps have already been drawn and the true researchers are already somewhere else. Now, if we want to foster science in Europe, we must never forget that knowledge and science are two very different things and we must stimulate each of them in their own and distinct way. And the ways are different. We tend to focus far too much on knowledge. In our schools, at our universities, we cram a lot of facts into the head of our students and stifle independent critical thinking. We should spend more time challenging existing facts and finding new ways to think about an established situation. The two always fight against each other, and we are too tradition heavy because knowledge is, in the end, tradition. It takes courage to focus on research and ignore part of the knowledge. But it takes courage, as I said, to be a good scientist. If we want to be innovative in Europe, we don't need more research programs and we don't need more bureaucratic visions. We only need a respect for three simple rules. One, we must rigorously but fairly select the most talented researchers, even if this contradicts the twisted view of democracy some people have. Second, we must give these carefully selected talents the necessary means to do their research, even if this means that the run-of-the-mill research gets less or perhaps even nothing at all. And finally, we must leave these talented people enough time to think and to follow their own ideas. At the end, I want to leave you with three tenets that are often proposed in the press and at public meetings, which may cause you some concern. One of these is that the days of the individual researcher are over. Today is the age of large groups of networks. Second, the days of hypothesis-driven research is over. Today, you screen large amounts of databases and other pieces of information with computers and select things by statistics. And the third is the demand that research must benefit society, your generation. You must valorize knowledge, as the newspeak goes. Now, to some extent, each of these three statements has a grain of truth in it. That's why they are so dangerous. But in the end, each of them is complete nonsense. First, all big discoveries in science, nearly without exception, have not come from groups or organizations, but from single creative individuals. And I see no reason that this will ever change. Second, today, when we have so much as for hypothesis-driven research, we have immense amounts of data. At no time before were we in such great need of a hypothesis to make sense of this flood of data. The more data you have, the more urgently you need a hypothesis to look at this data. Otherwise, they will drown you. And as for valorizing knowledge, if we insist that our research is geared to short-term intellectual or monetary profit, then we have found the best way to cripple innovation. So don't believe that. I believe in the end that your life in research will probably not be very different from my own life in research. And I can only hope that yours will be as happy as mine has been. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this highly inspiring talk about what we ever wanted to know about science but were afraid to ask. So to say, I'm sure there are remarks, questions, comments. If you have any, please wait until the micro has reached you. Who would like to start?
Courage is the most important thing in science.
Thank you very much for these insights into the scientific life. I am totally with you with the last three things you mentioned. But I'm not with you when you say that, or you compare only university life and university science with all the other science that exists on the Earth as well. And you have to discriminate between, let's say, the special example, EMPA, and probably a scientific work life at the university. So there are some institutes that have a more, let's say, target specific research area so that they cannot do everything. But of course, in the lab where you have a basic scientific research, then you can do and play around what you want to do. So there is a discrepancy between different organizations. What is your opinion about that?
I'm glad you brought up this point. I touched on these points, but probably too briefly. You know, there are basically, I would say, three types of research. There is the short-term research of a few years, we call it development, where you just improve something that's already there. Then there's the medium-term research, I would say time frame, 1 or 2 decades, for which probably EMPA is a good example, where the goal is still further off, where we are somewhere between industry and basic research. And then there's university research, which I said must be long-term, where we don't know how long it's going to take, and we don't even know what we're looking for often. And each of these three types of research is equally important. Each of them needs innovative, courageous minds. And they must overlap and help each other. The idea that one is better than the other is, of course, nonsense. And you are somewhere in the middle. At a very exciting crossroads, you must have qualities of both. You can't have the luxury like we have at universities and say, well, we don't know what we are looking for. people won't buy this from you. And yet, you don't have the luxury of knowing that you will have something in 2 years. So perhaps you are the most exciting one in between.
You said that, you know, we need the people, maybe the mavericks, the people that are less organized, and, you know, these are the people that can generate ideas. I think maybe the people that treat science like art. But how do those people become successful? Because if you're not organized, deadlines can get missed, papers don't get written. So how do those people stay in science and, you know, are able to have a career?
many of them fail. If I look, I've had about 100 postdocs during my career, and it was not always the brightest and the most courageous who became the most successful ones. If you can't meet deadlines and can't write papers and forget to put in your grant proposals, you'll fail. Or if you can't get along with your coworkers, it takes the other qualities. The best advice for such a bright but disorganized person is to join a well-organized, friendly lab for graduate work or for postdoc, to learn it by osmosis. And that's no guarantee of success, but that's what I would advise such a person.
You also mentioned that the three most important things is picking the right people, giving them the means to work, and then let them work. Where do you think where we have the biggest deficit among those three?
The selection, no question. Because there's no sure way to select the best people. It's like choosing stock. There's no safe way to choose only winning stocks. And it's even much harder to choose winning brains. But there are some people we know in the world of finance who have a damn good way of picking good stocks. And I know of many, no, not many, I know quite a few good people who have a knack for picking talented people. But you must risk mistakes. You will make mistakes. If you want to avoid mistakes, there will be no innovation. Let me stick this in. If nature had avoided mistakes during the evolution of life on Earth, we would all still be bacteria.
Thank you, Professor, for your inspiring speech. Do you think that in the recent times, the role of scientific communication to the public has increased even more, mostly for securing funding for basic research? In the modern times, have you think that the need for communicating to the public effectively has increased even more as compared to the previous years?
Yes, it's a very astute comment. The need for communicating what we do to the public is more urgent than ever, and it is in bad shape. Why is it more urgent than ever? Because it costs the public more money than ever. We demand a much bigger share of the gross national product for our research, and we have to explain what we are doing with the taxpayers' money. But most scientists don't see it that way. They think if you go to the public and talk about research so that everybody can understand you, you are a publicity hunter. It's considered to be slightly gauche. This has to change. And even the communication between the different scientific fields is in great danger. We are in danger of having another Babylonian confusion of tongues, because we are using so much slang now that even related disciplines in biology can't talk to each other anymore. An immunologist has so many acronyms, and the geneticist has other acronyms. It's like a dialogue of the deaf. We have to be very careful that we maintain communication in science between each other and between science and the public. If we fail in this, in the end, we will be the loser.
I had a question. Do you think science can be imported, or it should be generated in the heart of the society?
But it can be importable.
Yeah.
No. Science is something which cannot be bought and which cannot be developed overnight. It has to grow. You can import some people. But even then, you must let the scientific climate grow. I remember when I was a child in Austria, we had Russian soldiers. These were poor, illiterate farmers, guys who had suffered through this horrible war. They came to the city of Graz, and they said often, when they were a little bit drunk, let's have a party, let's make a park. Then they cut down the trees somewhere, stuck them in the ground, and they had a park for an evening, and then they went away. And then the trees wilted. And that's what happens now, as some of these Gulf states import theaters and universities. That's not going to work. You have to build it up slowly over a generation or two. It takes time. You cannot import it simply. You can plant it and then nurture it. And do something for the local talent. You can't just have people fly in and do science in Abu Dhabi. There must be people from Abu Dhabi, students like you, who will do this. And talent is something very precious. Many people say here in Switzerland too, talent will always make it. That's bullshit. Talents are very vulnerable, and we lose lots of talents with every generation because we stunt them, or we tell them that they are stupid and so on. We must nurture talent. It takes, I would say, to build up science in a place will takes at least half a century.
Masoud?
I have two questions, if you allow me to ask both of them. First question is a more basic one about the motivation and needs of the people who become scientists, who are scientists, or have been scientists. Are these needs, or the motivation of people have been the same throughout the history for being a scientist, or what? Because this is what people's moves people to do something, motivation, and needs, and for people who become scientists, I mean, they have, like all other people, they are born somewhere. They grew up under some conditions, and then they learn something, etc., etc. These needs, I mean, and motivation, could you please comment on that?
There's an easy answer to your question, which is a very good one. It's curiosity. We human beings are driven by curiosity. We always want new things. And this is also what makes us appreciate art. We want to see pictures which we haven't seen before. We want to hear sounds we haven't heard before. There's boring art as there's boring science. And if you see a boring picture, you have the feeling I've seen that before somewhere, somehow. And there's such science too. But we want always new sensations and new thoughts, and that keeps us forward. Now, where this comes from, as I mentioned, you have to have the right genes, but we also know there's the cultural imprinting, and today we know about epigenetics, that your parents can actually change your genes, and you yourself can change your genes chemically. And all this works together to give you a personality which could, if you're lucky, make you a great scientist. But the force that drives you, the gasoline that powers you, is curiosity.
Second one.
Question number two, yes.
Teaching. It was a very interesting comment on a good teacher. You said it's very important to be a good teacher, good professor, teaching, from the teaching point of view. And you said personality of a teacher is important. Could you please comment on that? What is the personality of a good teacher?
This cannot be easily defined. It has to be a whole human being. I would say it's the right balance between the brain and the heart. There are cold, inhuman scientists. If you're only a scientist, you quickly become inhuman. If you only go by the heart, you become a fundamentalist. But the art of life is to have the right balance between the two. That makes us humans. And we recognize this in people. That you don't do stupid things, but you don't only go by the brain. That's what we like. That's at least what I like.
Okay, we take one more. Harald, since you started, you can also have the last one.
Thank you very much. I can imagine what your opinion is about the fact that in Europe we have the tendency by the policy to press the universities into the application-related research. But how can we stop this? What can we do to stop this tendency?
To push universities toward applied research, yeah. Short-term research?
Yeah.
To have an enlightened science policy, to have people in government who understand science. Now, yes. I have spent 4 years in science politics, and I've been in parliament often, and of course, parliament nowhere in the world is a place of science. It shouldn't be. Politics and science have different logics, and they have to have different logics. But you need politicians who can listen to scientists and can talk back to them. They must be literate in science. They should not be scientists themselves, because scientists are really good politicians, and vice versa. But you need a dialogue between the political leader and the scientific advisors. And this does not work because the political leaders decide themselves. A huge arrogance at the moment, but in part, it's our fault, because older scientists who have the time to do that don't spend the time to try to get close to politicians, to establish contact, to tell them what's important. They think it's below their dignity. And that's why the politicians despise us. They think we are slightly crazy. This is true, by the way, but we are arrogant, and that's the problem. I'm glad you asked this as a final question. So when you are my age, in 100 years, think back to that. This is a duty all the scientists have, because we nothing can touch us. We have made our career. Nothing can do anything to us. They can maybe cut your salary or your pension. I don't know. But you should be able to fight for science. You have the experience. You have the connections. And hopefully you have the reputation. Then the politicians will listen to you, because they are smart. Politicians are generally very smart, in contrast to the general opinion. They just have a different logic.
Okay, thank you very much for those final remarks.